So here's presenting our first panel who will share their perspectives on the fintech industry. Join me in welcoming Bhavin Turakhia with awards like Young Global Leader and Trendsetter of the Year to his name. Bhavin has made a living example of his father's advice that you can achieve whatever you want if you just set your mind to it. So please put your hands together for Bhavin, the co-founder and CEO of Zeta. He is our panelist and moderator today.
Okay.
Joining Bhavin is Sachin Bansal. Sachin is a seasoned entrepreneur who changed the e-commerce landscape in India with Flipkart. For him, happiness is trying to solve a problem. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome on stage Sachin Bansal in his latest avatar as the CEO of Grids. Welcome, Sachin. Our next speaker is known as someone who challenges the norm and makes people think beyond the ordinary. So please put your hands together for Nitin Kamath, a sports enthusiast, a guitarist, full-time fan of Pink Floyd, and the founder and CEO of Zeroda. Welcome, Nitin. And finally, please welcome Kunal Shah, founder and CEO of Cred. Kunal believes that India is riding on a powerful wave of second and third time entrepreneurs. And after exiting his first startup, FreeCharge, Kunal is now making headways with his second company, Cred. Please put your hands together for Kunal. So a big welcome to all of our panelists. Let's give them another big round of applause. And audience, don't forget, this means that they're now in the hot seat. So you get to ask them those questions, right? So make sure that you do that. And on that note, Bhavin, over to you.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Okay, that was loud. well, thank you all for coming. Such an amazing gathering, by the way. I think in many ways, probably one of the largest gatherings of fintech founders that we've had in this country. And I'm actually humbled and honored to be together with this fantastic panel of entrepreneurs, all of whom I have tremendous respect for and have known for the longest period of time. And so yeah, the goal is today to spend some time, asking them questions. We're asking questions to all of us. I'd love for this to be conversational, so we'll try and do that for the first sort of part of this this panel out here. And then, as was mentioned, please visit slido.com and then put in the keyword Zeta, so on your phones, slido.com. And you can actually post your questions there and vote for questions that other people have posted there. And what we'll do after about 20, 25 minutes is we'll take the top questions that have come from the audience also sort of amongst us. So this is your opportunity to ask any of us any questions, if you will. So I'll actually kickstart the process from my side, and my first question, more than a question, is just sort of a get an introduction of everybody, because some of us here actually are in our second, third, or fifth startup, depending on depending on whom I'm talking about. But would love to actually get a quick introduction. I'll start from the extreme other end, Kunal, who's in a contemplative mood, for each of you to spend some time just talking about, give a quick introduction to yourself and what you're doing now, and what problem are you trying to solve. And why do you think the way you're trying to solve that problem is really 10x different from what's out there in the landscape?
I'll go first. I don't know how many startups I've done. Last one I was FreeCharge, but my first startup was running a cyber cafe when I was 16 from my home, so I can get money to have free internet at home. I've done many, many companies after that, but we obviously remember the ones which did have some impact. Cred is an unusual company, but it does make sense for India. My belief is that in a country like India, it's extremely hard to enforce differentiate between good actors and bad actors, and if we can systematically create an ecosystem where people of a certain financial behavior are rewarded for doing a good financial behavior, we can create a much larger ecosystem for them to benefit from, and more people being motivated to be in that. I think a lot of times these benefits are not understood by a lot of people because they don't live in a country that thrives on trust, right? We are living in a country where it's okay to expect things to not work perfectly. And if you can systematically make an impact for the individuals whose, let's say, credit score is high, then a lot of people will want to make their credit scores better or even know what their credit scores are. In the US, it's normal for people to care about it because you cannot even rent an apartment without a good credit score. Over here, we pay the price of paying 10 months deposit as a price of trust. And there are many, many things that around that, and hopefully we'll solve that.
Thanks for that, Kunal.
Nitin, yeah. Over to you.
So stock markets is the only thing I've done through my life. So started trading quite early. And I became a franchisee of a bigger brokerage firm. 2010, we started Zerodha with the idea of being a broker for very active day traders and futures and options traders. So it was, you know, the USP then was low cost. But then as we grew that business, we realized that active trade trading, futures and options community in India is maybe 300 to 500,000. So you can't really build a business. So then we started focusing on, you know, how do you get, you know, the investing audiences, which is maybe 5 to 10 million in India, to come to us. So the product journey started from then. So we built better investing platforms. And during the course, we also started a, you know, incubator fund, whatever you can call it. You know, it's called Rain Matter. So we started partnering with startups to come build on top of us so we can grow the ecosystem. So yeah, so today we've done quite okay as a business. We're the largest brokerage in the country, you know, a retail brokerage firm in the country. And yeah, but the problem for the business we have today is the market itself. I don't think there are too many people who have money in this country, you know, so you know, so we're kind of building business for them. So we have to figure how to get more money in the hands of people before, you know, they can invest, you know, so.
Over to you, sir.
Sure. So, of course, I mean, Flipkart started in 2007, and then I think exited last year, middle of last year, as part of the Walmart transaction. Post that, I have been exploring various opportunities, took a bit of a break for a few months, and then looked at various opportunities in the landscape in India. And see where I could apply my skills and knowledge that I had gained in Flipkart. Looked at education, looked at healthcare, and other problems that existed in the space. Around late last year is when finally decided to focus on financial services. And what attracted me to this sector is the size of the opportunity and also the level of extent of the problem that exists. In the ecosystem, if you look anywhere, India's credit to GDP ratio is close to 57%, which is growing at the same rate. The credit in India is growing at the same rate as GDP, which means that we'll never re-change that ratio if we continue to do that. So that has to change at some point of time. India has to exceed and go to 100% or even higher if you want real development, right? We want to get access to credit to millions of individuals who are credit worthy. Out there, individuals and businesses that are credit worthy, right? So that's a huge problem. And if you look at other parts of financial services, similar story, right? Insurance penetration, health insurance penetration. You talk about mutual funds penetration. It's just appalling, right? So how far behind we are. Of course, we have made a huge amount of progress in payments thanks to UPI. And I think that's something that is growing very well. I saw that story fold up very closely in PhonePe. PhonePe was the first UPI app in the country, and saw the impact from scratch. I think it wasn't clear back in 2016 whether UPI will have the kind of impact that it had. But I think given, now I'm more convinced, I think, just to go back a little bit, right? So on my financial services, since 2012, Flipkart every year had one project on payments, new project, mm-hmm. which we folded up and then started again, and again until PhonePe happened, right? So it wasn't that this overnight success kind of thing, it was like a annual event for us.
I don't think there's anything like an overnight success, by the way. All of us know that very painfully, but.
Yeah. No, I think and it's it just came through from a lot of trial and errors and pain, understanding the ecosystem and all of that, right? So I see that same thing can be done in all parts of financial services. All parts of financial services are up for that kind of transformation and change, and I want to make an attempt in a few of those areas, basically. That's what we are going to do. And we just got a lending license, and we are starting off in that business as well now. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I'll take a quick opportunity to kind of answer that question myself. Me and my co-founder, Ramki, we started Zeta in 2015. It's one of the many companies that I've been a part of as a founder or co-founder over the last 22 years since I've been a serial entrepreneur. And you know, payments is an area where, you know, much like I think many of the other panelists have covered, it's always fascinated me, and I've been always interested in it since a long time. It's a you know, potential to make an extremely large and huge impact across the globe. And in many ways, I think, you know, Zeta actually, so we strongly believe that the largest potential impact, that a significant potential impact is going to be made by transformation and digitization and modernization of the payments and banking landscape across the next 7 to 10 years. In fact, I would say a larger impact than what in many ways the internet and smartphones made. This has been a closed ecosystem for many, many decades, and for the first time now across the globe, funnily enough, regulation's actually ahead of technology. Everywhere, regulation's talking about open banking, giving access to sort of data for customers to be able to leverage for meaningful experiences, modernization, et cetera, but technology's actually not caught up. We also realize that in order to truly unbundle financial services and be able to offer lots of interesting innovative solutions, which by the way, I'm sure in this room, there are more ideas than most people even know of in terms of sort of changing the financial landscape. But we realize that, you know, we can't have tens of thousands of people apply for banking licenses. That doesn't make sense, on the one hand. On the other hand, you know, the banking ecosystem and banks in general don't necessarily have innovation in their DNA to get to sort of all possible areas of innovation and transformation. So this will have to be a meaningful partnership between these two worlds. But currently, there's actually no way, system, or mechanism for these two worlds to talk. Today, a typical fintech, you know, or a bank to launch a new modern product ends up taking 12, 18, 24 months at times, which is certainly not the time scale in which most of us have learned to operate. And so Zeta's actually built a modern universal issuance payment platform that can enable the creation of any fintech product or any banking product, asset, liability, or payment on top of our platform, and spin it out with a full-fledged experience in a matter of 60 to 90 days. It's a cloud-native, API-first platform that exposes banking services, payment services, and provides the entire ecosystem, you know, payment networks, banking networks, accounts, assets and liabilities, you know, processes around it, customer operations, fraud detection and management, and many other processes in the form of APIs that can be consumed by anybody, pre-integrated with existing banks and channels and networks that really, truly, meaningfully will accelerate the sort of journey of revolutionizing the fintech world and the fintech industry. So our clients would be banks, fintechs, neobanks, challenger banks, BFSI companies who we hope to enable to actually really and develop very quick and meaningful digital and modern experiences for payments. That's our thesis. But thank you guys for the answer. I'll actually digress a bit because, you know, Nitin, you spoke about the fact that there's not much money here in this country. That's actually an interesting topic, and I want to hear about that in terms of generally what are the thoughts of the different panelists about, you know, India and the potential to actually make revenue in India. And also, what are the thoughts, you know, are you planning to go global, or are there any sort of thought process in terms of taking this elsewhere for, you know, again, all the panelists, because yes, India is actually a low ARPU and a low revenue country in general. So, you know, why don't we start off this time, Sachin, with you? And
Yeah, I think it's interesting because the company that we just recently acquired, which is Creds, it is in the lower income segment. It operates absolutely only in the rural low income segment, and it's actually very profitable and growing very fast. And actually, most companies in that segment and banks who operate in that space actually are very profitable, right? So, I'm seeing a different kind of trend over here, right? And actually, the need and demand for financial services in those spaces is actually very high, very, very high. It's actually, we need to figure out ways to come up with unique solutions which are really low cost in operations and with mass distribution to be able to serve those needs. But the demand actually is very real and it exists across India. And the good thing is that as India is coming out of poverty, a lot of those customers will become middle class customers in the next 10 years. And we'll move to bigger cities over time, and all those things will happen, right? So if you take a long-term view, building services for those customers makes a lot of sense. So our focus actually is more on the middle income and the lower income segments. The middle income segment is what I am bringing now into this company. Lower income segment is what the focus that they already had, right? So that's what we are doing.
Yeah, so I mean, there are two aspects of our business, two pieces. One is the very active day trading, futures and options, you know, very niche, 500,000 to a million customers in this country who do this for a living, right? As in, they're trading 50, 100 times a day. That's how we make revenue, right? Because you know, there the value proposition is just not low cost; it's better product. You know, people need all kinds of tools, and think of it as car racing, right? As in, you know, you need your car to be fast to win that race, right? So that business is what helps us generate revenue. But the client base which invests in the capital markets. I mean, last year there were like 6 million Indians who invested once a year in the stock markets in India. I mean, it's really tiny, right? I mean, a lot of people keep giving this number of, you know, 3 to 4 crore Indians who have a DMAT account, but you know, an account with no activity is of no use, you know. So, and then the you know what we what a challenge for us is in the business of money, credibility also plays out, you know, in the sense. So most of our audience, 80% of our customers are below 40 years of age, and I think. This audience generally has lesser money to save, invest, as compared to who are more than 40 years of age, right? So we've been very unsuccessful at that audience who's over 40 because product experience is not something they appreciate as much as the younger crowd. And you know, brokerage costs, you know, once you have enough money, is not really an attraction as well, right? So I think this that's a challenge we have today. You know, is one is. This younger crowd in India, I mean, their spending habits are changing, but their saving, investing habits aren't. You know, like even people in our office, you know, they spend $500 on a beer, but then you say, invest in an SIP, then they're like, dude, what's the risk? Like, you know, how can you even ask that question? You know, as in, if you're okay spending on beer, I mean, you know, what risk are you talking about at 500 rupees for an SIP? Yeah, so it's... So we're trying to do this through education. You know, we run the largest education initiative around capital markets. But I don't think in this all the clutter around us today, people really have the bandwidth to sit and learn. So I think it has to be some niche product experience which pushes people to save, invest. And maybe, you know, it has to happen at the bank account level itself, because as soon as salary comes and it just disappears. You know, there's this really cool startup in the US called Digits, you know, their pitch is that I will take money without you knowing about it, right? In the sense, so they don't even say how much they're going to take out, right? So you just sign up and they just take away money, right? You know, and then
that can't go
right. So, but then yeah, it gets saved, it gets invested, so which is it's you know,
yeah. I think my view on this is. A lot of time we club too many things into one category. First of all, financial services is different when you have to give money and take money. And that's where the big line comes. And I believe that anybody who can offer the cheapest interest rate and the fastest possible way, it doesn't matter what the brand name is, it will work. Because you have to take money. When it comes to giving money, you will care about who are you, where are you from, how many years you've been in business, are you regulated, not regulated, all these hundreds of things come, and that's where the big line comes. The second thing is about country. We forget that a lot of global players have come to India because India is a large MAU farm for them, right? They are not interested in ARPU from this country, right? Because they have other countries where they get the ARPU from, they add the MAUs from here, and they make this beautiful large MAU, large ARPU company. When you are an Indian entrepreneur, please understand that you will also need to generate ARPU and MAU from this country, right? So just because, like say, we have 400 million people who have downloaded e-commerce apps, the number of unique customers transacting in this country is not changed much from when Sachin was running Flipkart to now. Like that volume has not become big because the money required is just not there. I was doing some research and I found out that around $450 billion are lying around in people's accounts right now at earning very low interest rate because we were told to save money, not to invest money. So we're saving money. And saving money is keeping in the account. Around 90% of this money is only in 22 million accounts. So the rest of the country is at less than 1,000 rupees account balance. Then we were curious that why are people doing that? So we asked a survey on our customers and we asked them, what do you think is interest rate on your credit card? And we found out that 75% of cred members who have high credit score thought the interest rate on their credit card is 16% or less per annum. And then we wonder why some of these things happen. We forget that most of us were never trained on how to work with money. We're the first generation who actually got money in the family. Most of us are the first ones who got credit card in the family or a home loan in the family or car loan in the family. Other thing about income not growing, last year 20 million women left the workforce in India. We are the lowest in the region in terms of female participation of labor. Only 8.5% of urban Indian women work. And that number is going down. Pakistan is 2 times more urban women working. Bangladesh is 68%. And we are delusional about these things. We are stuck on some wrong metrics. And we forget that we are still the country which puts this curtain when we get security check done for women. Like, we are that country. And we are not realizing that some of these factors are impacting growth because only unless both gender works, there is no trickle-down capitalism happening and 20 jobs created. For example, if both the genders are working, you will have two helps, two other support staff, and so forth, income keeps going down. We are actually going the opposite direction. So there is a fundamental issue. And then we have challenges where a lot of people who regulate the country in different capacities and different bodies are confused if you are socialism or capitalism. And then when I ask customers if you understand what is the difference between socialism and capitalism, they have no clue. For example, if I ask the audience that is MRP on this water bottle is great or not, they'll say, of course, it's great. But then you have not understood what capitalism is.
All right, well, that's interesting, always interesting perspective. I know I've heard this MAU farm phrase from you multiple times. I think you should trademark it.
I could if I could make money from
that. You know, I can just give some sort of quick perspective. I mean, Zeta's my fifth company. Historically, always been in B2B SaaS. That's been my sweet spot for the last, so even, you know, consumer flavors of our companies and my businesses have been B2B2C, if there's any consumer flavor per se. And historically, every single company that I've been a part of, either as a founder, co-founder, more than 80%, in some cases, 90, 95, 98% of our revenue comes from outside India. So India has always been, I mean, I love the kind of talent out here. We build amazing products. Really optimize the model of sort of building stuff here, selling elsewhere. I've invariably found, again, if you get it right, that typically for every dollar that we spend on GTM, on go-to-market, in India versus US, we make between 3 to 7x more revenues in the US for that same dollar versus in India. So it's actually cheaper, again, if done right and with the right quality product, et cetera, to actually make a meaningful, sizable business in the US. And we were looking at payment volumes. You know, last year, credit card, debit card, UPI, I mean, UPI is growing pretty strongly, but, you know, combined volumes are around $300 billion in the country. U.S., you know, payment volumes are at about $6 to $7 trillion, right? So there's a massive gap in comparison in terms of just the pure numbers, and so historically, we've always paid more attention to some of those markets. Having said that, I mean, I do partially also agree with Sachin, kind of what you were saying. I think in financial services, there is a meaningful opportunity in India. I think, to Kunal's point also, that everybody needs to, and people need to identify and understand where their opportunity is as opposed to following myths. There are about 56 million tax-paying individuals in the country. So that's, you know, that's pretty much the
tax filing individuals
in the country, right? So tax paying would be a subset of that. About 800,000 companies that file for taxes. And so in a country of a billion people, you know, that's the subset that's actually filing taxes, paying taxes, etc. There is an opportunity to make meaningful revenue out of each of these individuals, depending on the value that you're adding for them. But that's really, you need to decide your focus in terms of what you're looking at and what your, the target segment that you're approaching, what kind of problems you're solving for them. And so even in B2B SaaS, we've conventionally found companies in the US, companies in Europe, companies in other developed markets, even in LATAM, in some cases, will be more willing to pay for software in comparison to India, though that's changing again now more rapidly. But yeah, that's my kind of quick sort of perspective and my experience. I'll actually take a quick question from Slido. So we have about 5-6 questions. By the way, people who want to ask questions, as I said, please go to slido.com and put in Zeta and post or vote on existing questions. So there's a question here that says, what is more important, go-to-market or product? Kunal, why don't we start again from you?
There is no difference between the two. I think good products will naturally have great GTMs. And if you believe that you have a great GTM and a terrible product, then you have not understood what is product. And product is not this illusionary thing that one person does in the company. Everything you do is product. I believe in internet businesses, distribution matters a lot more before, let's say, something like monetization kicks in, and that's why getting that right, getting your cost of distribution right, is actually super critical, and otherwise you can just waste a lot of time. If you are competing with traditional businesses, you have to realize one thing, that you have the opportunity to reach all these hyper-connected Indians who are on their smartphone, who can download your app in one click. In that situation, getting that right, and I think a lot of people forget that it is strong. Actually, let me ask you a question. How many of you are on Cred? Please raise your hand. Okay, great.
Whoa.
How many of you downloaded Cred because you saw the ad?
Which
Perfect.
Ad?
Now, it's good. My team's working hard, so it's working. The point is that if I have to spend ad dollars to get to affluent audience, then you can just burn a lot of money and never get to a scale or size.
Yeah, I agree. I think low-cost distribution is part of the product. I mean, if you don't solve for low-cost distribution, then there's no product, essentially. If your cost of distribution is high, there is. I don't think it's a choice for most people. And not just for tech businesses, but for offline businesses as well.
Yeah, no, for us, I mean, product, but then once the product and the distribution was put in play, now it's go to market with all the new, I mean, I might think of an idea right now and by Monday we are live with something new. And because there it helps to stay ahead of the competition to have these new features and tools. You know, there it's, I think it's important to be there faster than others, but otherwise, yeah, it's products more important.
Awesome. I'll give sort of a partially overlapping, partially different perspective. I think GTM is actually, to me, important in different ways at different life cycles of an organization. By the way, I made most of my mistakes on the product side of the equation, starting off with the hypothesis or idea that I felt was next best thing since sliced bread, and it was actually crap and didn't make any sense. And in fact, vast majority of these scenarios, your hypothesis that you start with, unless you go to market with it, you're never going to be able to validate it. So I mean, typically, as an entrepreneur, you start with a hypothesis or idea. And I mean, I think this industry has a love for acronyms, right? So we first try to create an MVP, that's kind of based on our hypothesis, a minimum viable product. Then we go to PMF, product market fit. And so there's go to market important. At product market fit stage, your goal should be to acquire enough customers that are going to give you a positive retention curve so that you can validate that you actually have product market fit. So it doesn't have to be millions, it doesn't have to be thousands, it could be 100 customers, but if 100 customers are out there that are willing to pay for or use your product and be engaged with it and it's solving a meaningful problem, and they're retained customers, you've solved for product market fit, right? The next step, you get to a sales-ready product where you have no choice but to go out on the market to truly understand whether the unique selling proposition that you have is what's really, you know, is what's really sort of at the core of what people are buying your product for, et cetera, to convert it into sort of the relevant collaterals, preparing your sales teams. Then you have to get to LTV greater than CAC. So you want to get to a stage where lifetime value of each customer that you bring in is greater than the cost of acquisition of each customer. Here, GTM now becomes sort of a, you know, a play to try and figure out that what's the traction channel that you're going to use. Is it going to be, you know, ads, for instance, or is it going to be, you know, word of mouth? Is it going to be viral marketing? Is it going to be and figuring out BD, which is kind of one area that we've dominant, you know, predominantly used. And then once LTV is greater than CAC, then you put capital in and substantially scale GTM. So in some ways, go-to-market actually is an important facet at every single stage. And so is product, because at every single stage, you're sort of also evolving the product as you go along. So ignoring GTM and locking yourselves up in an ivory tower and building an amazing product, as I said, I've done that in my life, is the biggest waste of capital and resources. Start talking to customers as early as possible. Start validating your hypothesis and ideas as early as possible, as quickly as possible. And you know, that would be kind of my perspective. All right, we'll take another question from the board. This question is to Sachin and Nitin. Why are most of the wealth management players solving for execution as a problem while not solving for advisory? Nitin, do you want
to? I mean, no, this is very close to heart. So I think the challenge in this country has been that people who've been selling financial products, they've been earning from the manufacturers. So there's always been a conflict of interest. So people have always sold what makes the most money for the for them and not really what's most beneficial for the customers. One of the reasons why I think US, a market like US is so ahead of us is because there is a professional advisory ecosystem. And professional advisors tend to make your clients as well professional, right? As in India, we don't have professional advisors saying the right things to the customers, which means that customers end up, you know, picking up wrong habits and saving and investing in the wrong kind of products. Why we're not solving for it, Indians don't like to pay advisory fees, yeah. Right? You know, so if you don't like to pay advisory fees, you have to make money from the manufacturer, right? So it's, I mean, I don't know if anyone's tracking here, there's been this whole shift. You know, SEBI has been coming down quite hard on AMCs, on how much they charge and how much is passed back. So the entire distribution crowd in this country is slowly moving away to selling insurance as an investment vehicle, right? Because, you know, by selling insurance, you can make a lot more commissions than what you can by selling mutual funds, right? So which means it's actually going to harm this country quite a bit, you know? So so the issue today is, why are we not solving for the problem? Because I don't know how we're going to ask a customer to pay advisory fees, right? Like, I'll just give you an example. You know, there's a close friend of mine. He had a portfolio of 1 crore rupees in mutual funds, in a regular fund, where the person who sold the fund makes 1 lakh rupees, a percentage of this crore, as commissions per year, right? So I told him, dude, you do the choice on your own. You decide which fund to buy. Why are you paying this commission? Why don't you come to Zerodha, open a direct mutual fund account and do this for free? I mean, at that point of time, we were charging 50 rupees a month for using this platform. So he shifts this 1 crore portfolio to our direct mutual fund platform. And then in 2 months, he's like, Nitin, you're 50 rupees a month. Isn't it too much? I mean, I'm like, dude.
I have a strong point of view about this. Any country that truly does not understand compound interest is more penny-wise and pound-foolish. And therefore, it's impossible to make pennies from a country where you are level 7 karate black belt on saving pennies, right? So, for example, we will spend disproportionate amount of money on education of our children, because that's pound foolish behavior sometimes. But when it comes to 5 rupees delivery fee on Swiggy, you're like, how dare they like write a tweet about it, right? The point is that if you truly don't understand the value of time, then you will never pay money for that. And therefore, Indian entrepreneurs will not pay for SaaS, because we are penny-wise. Aisa kaisa 50 rupees per user for doing payroll? Find me 5 rupees guy, right? Or 2 rupees guy. The thing is, the value of time is a core concept that we have not understood, to be able to understand that pennies can save you pounds.
Yeah. No, I agree. I think I agree with Nitin completely. There is a lot of mis-selling in the space right now. I mean, I saw one. There was an insurance product, which I saw, and
which basically said that if for 10 years you pay the premium regularly on time, at the end of the 10th year, will give you 20% return. Right? And people fall for it. It's not even as good as savings bank account. I mean, right? So, it's just appalling. And it's actually being sold as a great product, right? And because the life insurance company and the agents tend to make a killing on this essentially. I think the reason for all this is, as I see from my limited exposure so far, is that one is people don't understand compound interest. I don't think anywhere in the world people understand compound interest, not just in India, I think.
Yeah.
It's actually extremely hard.
But they
don't
understand the value of time, though, and I think that's an important
thing. We were never paid hourly salary, Sachin, right? So we never understood what the value of 1 hour is. How many of you know what's your hourly income? Please raise your hand. 3-4 of you. How will they make good decisions with 1 hour of their time? How do they know?
Salary to aayi rahi hai na.
Monthly salary.
Whether you spend it on.
See, the monthly salary concept, when you get from first, your first job is monthly salary. In the US, your first job is hourly salary. Your unit of time is set on an hourly basis.
It's too much, it's too complicated. I think we can't expect, common people cannot do that much math. I think absolutely, I don't think we should expect them to. And even if you show them a table, it won't make sense. I think the life insurance company that successfully did it, they were able to sell because they super simplified the whole proposition, saying 10 years pay on time and get 20%. And that 20% sounds better than 4% or whatever, 8% of FD, right? So, so I think now coming to this, right? So I feel that one of the reasons why this is there is because of the stage at which our market is, right? Today the problem is distribution. People just don't have access to it. So execution is getting rewarded by the market if you're able to convince people and get them on board. And there are lots of people who need these services. Than the quality, the quantity is right now being rewarded than the quality. I think that's one of the reasons why. Execution is Trump's advisory as of now.
Yeah, but the real opportunity is actually, I think, today in solving for advisory, because there are so many people solving
for a certain segment of users, absolutely, the top segment of users.
I mean, cheers. No.
Awesome. I'll take a quick sort of side question now. So just want to quickly ask the panelists and contribute to the notion of like, what do you? I mean, the latest rage right now is fintech. You know, there was a time it was, I don't know, food delivery services. There was a time it was, I don't know, pool table outlets in Mumbai. Like, there was to be one at every nook and corner until all of them shut down, right? is fintech a fad? More importantly, what, according to you, at a macro level, are the biggest opportunity areas that, you know, people in the audience of fintech should focus on that could become meaningful businesses in India, let's say, specifically? Sachin, do you want to kick off?
I don't think it's a fad. I think, yes, there are lots of startups, and that's what happens in any sector which shows promise, right? And good people jump in, investors come in along with to invest behind promising companies. I feel that the level of underpenetration, as I started off, right, exists in every part of financial services is so high that India will need a lot more dollars, a lot more startups than what we have today to actually solve this problem really, really well in the next 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. And I think if you're serious about financial services, that what I've realized so far is that nothing is going to happen in the short term, right? So I think you have to take a long-term view of things, and investors and entrepreneurs both have to be patient for a long period of time. But the rewards at the end of the whole thing could be extremely significant if you are able to stick in it, right, for a long period of time. I do feel that actually there are lots of big problems to be solved, and we need more good people.
I've been, like I said, you know, a trader through my life from when I was 16, 17. And then, until 2 years back, until Zerodha, I was told to go get a real job. They're like, what is this broking and stupidity? And the first few years of a business, you know, when you're trying to hire people, again, you know, in India, broking isn't really looked up in great regards, right? So it was very tough to kind of get talent to come work with you. But the last 3 years have been brilliant, you know, like we're suddenly a fintech, you know, so, and, you know, so it's like wherever I go, I'm like, dude, you know, you founded a fintech company, you know, so, no, I mean, I don't know if it's fad or whatnot, but it's helping us, you know, to be called as fintech, because it's easier to hire talent today than what it was before. And like I said, you know, I think in the space of saving and investing, the opportunity I see is around advisory, you know, so because today what happens is, you know, like I question myself sometimes, be, you know, morally question myself of being an execution platform. Today the stance we take is that I don't care what the customer does on the platform. I want to offer these financial products with the, you know, easiest possible way at the lowest cost to the customer. Now, is he actually investing in the right product or not is, you know, I mean, today we are saying we don't care, but I don't know if there's a right stance to take. But yeah, we still don't really have a solution of how that problem is going to get solved. So if there's someone who's looking at this space, I think this is the opportunity. And the big challenge in the country also is that people who don't know what is the right financial product to invest in, once they take that position in it, you know, they become inactive very fast. Right, so like, you know, we run one of the largest direct mutual fund platforms in the country, and last 4 to 5 months, you know, between regular mutual funds to direct mutual funds, the number of SIPs which are stopped in direct mutual funds are multifolds of what are stopped in regular funds. So, you know, so let on their own, I don't think retail investors know what is the right thing to do. So I think advisory is where I think the real opportunity exists in this space. You know, so.
My view is reason financial services is or fintech has picked up recently is that what the world has observed is that when it comes to local markets, there is one industry that seems to be sort of a having some kind of a protection from global companies coming and participating is financial services, because the regulator ensures that in many ways, and you'll see very few companies have a global footprint when it comes to actually being involved with money, right? And except Visa and Master, who managed to kind of be behind the regulated rails of banks and others, very few categories have actually emerged to kind of cross borders. And 40 to 50% of all market cap, public market cap, and profit pools are in financial services, right? So that kind of proves that there is a market that exists to start with. And the third thing is that we are entering a phase where the consumers, at least the top 20 million, are exposed to global products, and they expect a certain level of sophistication in their product experience, which creates an opportunity. It's very hard to copy global models for India, and I think a lot of people make that mistake. For example, if somebody says, I'm trying to build Stripe for India, you'd understand that the credit card take rate in the other markets is close to 3-3.5%. If somebody tells me I'm going to build Nubank for India, I wonder that they realize that there is 175% interest rate on credit cards in Brazil to bring this over here, and somebody tells me I'm going to make payments, they don't realize UPI is almost free. The point is that you have to understand the market nuances and play for that. And you have to understand that we are not a country where we can play capitalistic games easily, because where a regulator will say, hey, you cannot make super normal profits behind some of these things, so your business models have to be constantly thinking about that from day zero versus trying to say, I will figure it out over a period of time. The reality of the market is that I'm not an engineer, I'm a philosophy major, unusual founder in tech. I've seen that a lot of founders who have an engineering background love to start building and coding and not do market research and spend a lot of time evaluating. I remember meeting Sachin before he decided what he wants to do, and he gave me a perspective on education that and why you cannot create a really large company on education, and that level of research required to pick your bet is extremely important. This fail fast is useful in markets which has massive depth. In a country which is just this thin, fail fast is almost fatal.
By the way, I personally think that fail fast is just a very good buzzword that a lot of people use. I don't necessarily say that it's not a good prescriptive methodology in some experiments, when you're looking at experiments, but I mean, I'm with you. Ramki and I spent a year researching the entire financial services space across the globe, literally what we call doing homework every day. So, you know, 3 hours of homework every day whilst doing other things to actually decide which of the areas we're gonna launch in.
Yeah.
Same thing when I started Radix. I spent 2 years researching the space to figure out exactly which strings we're gonna go after. And so there's certainly a lot of effort that goes behind figuring out the opportunities. I guess my quick sort of take on, so firstly, Zeta for us is not, these days this word is also sort of quite abused, right? Everybody's a neobank, everybody's a challenger bank, everybody's a fintech, and there's no clear distinction, and then there's sort of, you know, tech fin, and there's like all these other sort of buzzwords that we're using. Zeta actually, we're a platform play, so we power banks, fintechs, any financial institution like, so in some sense we're not really a fintech ourselves. But I think there's, you know, the way I see it is when I look at existing profit pools in the financial services space, Kunal, you said that vast majority of the market cap today in the country is amongst financial services, but if you really investigate the profit pools, you know, firstly it's banks. Banks make vast majority of their money through lending.
Yeah.
Lending goes to the person with the smallest, lowest cost of funds. A lot of people seem to be thinking that, oh, I'll come up with a new algorithm for lending that will identify people who haven't been lent to before. Great, you will discover them for the first time, lend to them probably for the first time, but now they are in the system, so somebody with a lower cost of funds will lend to them for the second time. So technically, it's just a benefit for the first loan. And so really, you know, in lending, cost of funds wins out unless you're a regulated entity and you can optimize on cost of funds and then, you know, delinquency rates, et cetera. You don't have much of a play there. So that's definitely one profit pool. The second profit pool is a platform play, which is sort of providing technology. You know, in the California gold rush, the people who made the most money, I guess, in some sense, are the ones who are selling the pickaxes and shovels. I would say in the B2B SaaS space, there is potential money because there's a lot of problems companies face in the mid-market and upwards segment in payments, and improving that can result in B2B SaaS revenue. That's definitely a space that we've seen revenue pools existing in. SMB and retail is hard. Again, not, you know, unfeasible, but certainly harder than all the other profit pools per se. So those are my kind of quick perspectives on pools and areas of opportunity. I'll take one last question from the sort of Slido board. How do fintech companies stay ahead of the curve, anticipating regulations from state/government, which might turn out to be detrimental in doing business? Nitin, why don't we start with you? You were talking about SEBI and stuff, so yeah. You know, in some sense, you know, that topic is also close to your heart.
Right.
So yeah, how would fintech companies stay ahead of the game or ahead of the curve?
No, I mean, so we just had like a meeting with our growth team recently, and we were trying to, you know, I was trying to tell them the biggest risk we run as a business is actually the regulatory risk. Because I don't know if there's any way to stay ahead of it. I think what has helped for us in the last few years, I mean, from the time we have started the business, is that we have never done anything that can compromise the interest of a customer, right? And not just us as a business, you know. As a tech business, you need to stay ahead of regulation somewhere. You have to take some chances, but make sure that what you're doing can't be misused by someone else. And you know, clients' interests compromised on. So there are many ideas we have let go of as a business. But that said, you know, regulations in this country are always made for bad actors, and then financial crimes in India have the least penalties of sorts. So, you know, so there are always a lot of bad actors around. Companies like, just to give you an example, we are starting a loan against securities business. We spent a year of effort in building the platform out, where, you know, if you have some securities, you can pledge the securities and borrow money against it, right? So when you pledge the securities move from your account to the NBFC account. Now, this was probably like a 15,000-20,000 crore market, and it was all killed overnight, right? Because, you know, once the securities moves out of the customer's account, it can get compromised on, right? So I don't know if there is a way to stay ahead of the regulation, but I think the best thing to do is make sure whatever you do, you know, you don't do anything that can be compromising clients' interests.
Yeah, I think I would share my perspective on this. Right? So what I've seen so far is that you need to understand your regulator better first, right? So go ahead, if it's SEBI, if it's IRDAI, it's RBI or whoever it is, right? Understand them very well. They have a certain culture. They're not individuals, right? They're a machine. They are a process-driven organizations most of the time, and they will have a certain way of thinking. There are regulators who, if you go and ask them a question, and if it's in the gray zone, they will not give you a clear answer, right? They will not say yes or no. But there are regulators who, if you ask a question and it's in the gray zone, they will just say no, right? So you have to be careful who you're dealing with, right? So you don't always, I mean, my general belief is that you should embrace the gray zone, right? With open arms and be ready to play in that. Yes, once in a while, something like this will happen. Regulators will change the regulations, but most of the times you will get actually rewarded because then the regulations will be created around you. And especially as when you are applying new technology to an old area, you will find things which are unclear, undefined. It's not always the best choice to go and ask the regulator, right? So sometimes it's good to just assume that that is okay and go ahead, right? But again, as I said, be cautious about it. Understand your regulator. I know it's hard work, but it is required. I mean, we are in a heavily regulated industry, and this is part of the job.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
So I think one thing you have to understand that in a super connected world, copying regulations from developed markets is faster than copying innovations from developed markets. And therefore, we are going to be always in a situation where a lot of times aggressive stances on what went wrong in other market will be taken first over here, even before it starts. I'll give you a small example. P2P lending became huge, and then it was regulated in China, and then it normalized. We got the regulation before anybody became a P2P lending company over here. So a lot of times you have to understand that.
And same thing can happen with data privacy and things like that, right?
So we have to understand that copying regulation is super easy, and therefore we are going to be always in a world which is going to be playing this game carefully. Now, good news is, like Sachin said, it's worth it. Know your regulator, and anything that is worthwhile is ideally never easy. So that's the game.
Awesome. Well, with that, we have a big sort of red screen here that says time's up. But these were sort of really interesting questions. And I would like to sort of join everybody in giving a round of applause for these amazing speakers on our panel. Smriti, what do we have next? Okay, so we do have a quick sort of token of appreciation for you guys. Thank you so much, Sachin, Nitin, Kunal, for joining us. And
cheers.
Thank you once again, guys, and once more, a big round of applause for an amazing panel.